know, I know it's getting late. Believe me, more than you do. I've had this all planned out. We'll be done by 9:30. But, you know, as things go, we plan for that, and, you know. Wow. I can tell you that I'm going to make this brief, succinct, and let's get on with the party, but I'm not. Because this is the one chance in a lifetime, and we paid thoroughly enough for Mr. Quick, and I want you to thoroughly enjoy his expertise, and we will stay here tonight till the cops come and stop us. So do not worry, do not fret. My pages, speech is 7-8 pages long. And I encourage all my students to have a seat. And don't make any noise. And if our next door neighbor cranks some music, I'm gonna pause for a moment and I want you, Mr. Quick, to blast even louder. So, I shall begin. If I can read what I got here. Thank you, Rinaldo. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, students, parents, and fellow Hwarang warriors. I thank you from the bottom of my heart for your attendance and your support for making this event possible. Before I begin, I would like to take this time to recognize the members of the 8th Dan Banquet Committee for their hard work and selfless contribution in making this event a reality. Tony Diaz, for video presentation, which he has spent countless hours in reviewing over a terabyte of videos and pictures to extrapolate an eloquent yet powerful summation of the Hwarangdo family and my journey. Fernando Ceballos and Raymond Fong for implementing an effective online campaign to organize and raise the funding necessary to make this evening a great success. Rick Robbins for designing the classic look and feel of our online campaign. Daniel Gonzalez for designing all the graphic elements that went into the publishing of tonight's event. Glenn Mantell, for making it possible for me to present to you a small yet poignant gift in the way of the Tanbong. Reynaldo Macias, for accepting the daunting task of being tonight's master of ceremony and for doing a fantastic job. Antonio Goodwin, for connecting us with one of the top DJs in the country, Mr. Quick, whom you will witness in a short while. Hopefully. My brother-in-law, Danny, for providing the video projector. Joy Klein, for organizing all the people to work together harmoniously in making the planning process as smooth and flawless as possible as their team leader. And of course, my sister, Dr. Janet Lee, for designing and decorating the centerpieces, as well as coordinating the beautiful setting we are graced with tonight. And to my sister, Stacy Lee, for being the handy helper to both my mother and my sister. The last couple of months have been quite interesting, to say the least. I was first approached by George Nim over a year ago when he invited me to test for my eighth dan. At the time, I humbly declined, as I thought, like a bottle of fine wine, I could wait a couple of more years so that I may age properly. I have never been interested in acquiring higher dans as most other martial artists I have witnessed. The way I see it, rank is something that the master offers his student as a gift when the student is ready to accept the responsibilities of such title and rank. And it has always been my philosophy that one hwarang should conquer a thousand. So no matter the rank, as a hwarang, we must always be prepared to accept whatever the challenge, however large or however small. However, this spring marked the 100th black sash examination, and I could not pass up this benchmark in our history. There is so much I would like to share with you. You will take the breath of this entire Memorial Day weekend. And you know I would do it. And then some, to fully express all the feelings, thoughts, and reflections I have had in these trying months. However, I know Mr. Quick is waiting anxiously to get the groove on, and I am sure you are as well. Thank you. So I shall attempt to tell you about what is most important, most valuable, the ideal of one. You are all here tonight thinking that you are honoring me. Well, if so, then my head fake worked. As the late Randy Pausch, a professor at Carnegie Mellon, dying of pancreatic cancer, says in his last lecture, which he gave in front of all his students and colleagues, that the greatest lessons are learned indirectly. And he finishes his lecture by telling everyone that the lecture was not for you, but it was for his children. So I say to you, this banquet is not for me. It is for my father, my mentor, my master. My trials, my accomplishments are nothing. My hardships, my sufferings, I have none. All I am and have done dwindles in comparison to my master. My journey is smooth sailing in flat waters compared to my master's journey through a tempest. He was born the fourth son of a sibling of seven children. He started his training at the young age of four. He trained in the mountains of North Korea under the strict guidance of his master, Swan Dosa, a hermit monk. He escaped the communist regime of the dictator Kim Il-sung during the Korean War. He survived through the impoverished, war-torn conditions during the Korean War. He left home to work and help support the family at the age of 16 years old. He systemized the knowledge passed to him from his master into a modern martial arts system, introducing it to the public for the first time in 1960 in Seoul, Korea. He had the first post-war nationally televised martial art expo in the largest and only sports stadium in Korea, Changchung Jaeukgwan. He met with Korea's former president, Park Chung-hee, and was given the responsibility to create one unified Korean martial art. He attempted twice to form the Korean Unified Martial Art System, which was dismantled both times. In the process, he aided in the development of Kuksul-1 and Hapkido. He bumped heads with the former KCIA director and won his allegiance. He protected his community in Seoul against the rampant bullying by unruly thugs. He created the Korean Hwarangdo Association and opened 28 schools in Seoul, Korea, alone. He single-handedly was responsible in bringing over all the members of his immediate family to the United States, which consisted of his parents, two sisters, one brother-in-law, three brothers, two sister-in-law, three nieces, four nephews, two daughters, two sons, and his wife. He has revived the Hwarang Nights and brought their significance in the modern consciousness and to the minds of all martial art practitioners today. He has authored three books and co-authored three more. He was instrumental in elevating the hand-to-hand combatives of the elite U.S. Armed Forces through mentoring and cultivating the former head instructor of the Special Forces Green Beret, the late Michael Ichanis. He secured the name Hwarangdo and all of its intellectual property by acquiring the first trademark for a martial art and copyrighted all of its curriculum for the first time in history. Without him, the world would have known the Hwarang only as a group of flower boys who rode on horseback and shot arrows. Diminished as an archaic cultural side note on tour guidebooks of Korea. I have yet to mention of his physical prowess and accomplishments. He was the first to rotate 540 degrees in the air, striking a target 10 feet in the air with his foot. His toja in his school had footprints all over the ceiling. He was the first martial artist to be aired on ABC's TV show. That's incredible. He has had cars and trucks run over his stomach. He has had thousands of pounds of rock slabs smashed over his body with sledgehammers. He is the first and last, with only me coming close, to have successfully completed a five-directional cut of watermelons held against the naked stomachs of his students while blindfolded. He has taken down a bull with one blow, and in the deep recesses of his mind, training under his master, he has fought against tigers. There is a saying in Korea that when you live long enough, you shall endure all of its pain. As my father has been a witness to my journey, so too I have witnessed, fortunately or not, much of the hardships and heartaches that my master had to endure throughout his teaching career. If I have taught thousands of students, then he has taught tens of thousands of students. And although the reward of seeing a person blossom, transform, and become the potential that they all possess is priceless, it takes 1,000 disappointments for one moment of satisfaction. Above all, we as Hwarang cherish and hold in the highest regard the virtue of loyalty. If I have faced countless betrayals, then my master has faced too many for words to do justice. I have seen my father take in students from the streets in their teens and raise them as his own child, as his own children. With my mother feeding and nurturing them with kindness and love to the point where at times I felt jealous at my father, for he has always been the strictest with me, only to have them grow into manhood, acquire a taste for power, yet sophomoric, short on wisdom, and claim their superiority to the unfathomable extent where Dojinrin had to witness one of his students, whom he took in without question, once again treating him like his own son, in front of him say, "With all my vast knowledge of Korean martial arts, I have created Hwarangdo and all of its curriculum." And this all done after being sworn in under the name of God. I have known a Buddhist monk who called himself the Mop. Mop. Kolle. When I asked him, "Why do you call yourself the Mop?" he replied, "Because like a mop, I clean all things. Yet like a mop, I am always dirty." Unlike most teachers, we parent. When teaching your children, just teaching is not enough. You must make sure they learn the lesson. And even though you have been scarred, dirty from past disappointments, you must once again teach with conviction and love. For as children, they can feel you more than they can hear you. And even when you are at the brink of disillusionment in people, you must believe in them even when they do not believe in themselves. To be truthful, formal classes with Dojunim for me, I can count with my fingers. It's the lessons I have learned in observing him as a teacher, a father, a husband, a man, which are most profound and have taught me the most. Most of what I've been witness to are heartaches, pains, and sorrows. I have never seen him adorned with great gifts from his students. I cannot remember when was the last time one of his instructors treated him to a fine dinner. I have never seen him take a vacation or his master treat him to one, and I am just as guilty. Most of what I have seen have been painful. I have heard students' complaints and resentments of my master, which only showed their lack of understanding, compassion, and only revealed their self-entitled nature. However, even after witnessing all his trials and hardships, I was inspired to be like him. He was my mountain. He was the one. The one person who have committed his entire life to one thing, to one love, to one passion. Whenever I felt I was all too much, it was all too much, all too painful. When my heart lay wasted in pieces, all I needed to do was to think of my father, my master, as he lived twice as long and has taught twice as much and have endured twice as much. I could not complain, but only admire. It is this that I am an heir to. No raise in salary, no fortune, just more mopping. The lessons I have learned from him are too many to tell in one sitting. It will take a lifetime. So I shall share with you all that I have learned from my master, if you will share your life with mine. And we shall mop the world together as one, to hopefully instill the power of one, To believe in the self as all great things started from one person. Then when all people are self-empowered, then hopefully we can all live together as one in peace, in harmony. There are too many people for me to thank. So before I close, I would like to recognize few of the people who are in attendance tonight who have made an impact in my life as well as made great sacrifices to be present. Sensei Taro Ariga, for having an open mind, helping me to realize my vision of a new weapon fighting method. Dr. Mark Chang, whom I have known for 20 years, for being a great brother and for keeping me in the minds of all martial artists. Susok Sabam Dylan Cerny, for accepting me as his grandfather and for being my proof that we are on the right track. Susok Sabam Scott McKnight, whom I have also known for over 25 years, for his undying loyalty to me when I was a child and now hopefully a man. Dr. Richard Downey, whom I have known for over 25 years, for his dedication to his country and never forgetting his Hwarang spirit. My sisters, Dr. Janet Lee and Stacey Lee, for their unconditional love and support, and mostly to my mother, as she is my teacher of compassion and forgiveness. I love you too, Mom. Also to my students for believing in me and always challenging me to be better, to be a better teacher. And especially to my nephews, Luke and Jeffrey, and my youngest student of 4 years old, Rod Asghari, for giving me hope for our future. Furthermore, I would like to thank all of our critics and anyone who opposes our way for keeping a sharp and alert always. My father has said that warriors do not retire, we die. Although I am most honored and privileged to be the heir to Hwarangdo, I must endure the greatest loss in order to claim it. I will promise in front of all attending witnesses that I shall do my best to secure Hwarangdo for the next generation, not only preserving my master's life's work, but fulfilling his vision. I will accept once again his challenge, which he has set forth for me to be second, but making second remembered as much or more as the first, or die trying. 대단히 감사합니다. 도주님, my father, my master, my king. 화랑 forever, yours and my students' humble servant, 태준 Lee.
Thank you.
I think that's about it, and I think we're ready to groove. So I thank you all. I really, you know, I'm not lost for words, right? I already said all the words. Let's have a good time. And I really hope that you will carry home with you some great memories tonight. And I know some of you might think that, you know, hey, we take this too seriously. And you're absolutely right!
Ladies and gentlemen, the dance floor is open. Ain't no party like a Juan on party. You know how we do.